So this is how design and business used to exist for a long, long time. They were both very comfortable with each other, right? One could say they were sleeping partners too. That was design and that was business. Then something happened and you got... So sustainability came on. And they became a delightful threesome. Unfortunately, business still doesn't understand sustainability as well. And design also doesn't understand sustainability as well. So he's the late comer to the party. Did I say he? Okay, I don't know if it's a he or a she. Let me be gender neutral on that. So what is sustainability? That is the key question that we are all asking. That's what business is asking. That's what even design people are asking each other. That what is sustainability? Is it, excuse the gender, is it a bitch which you have to deal with? Or is it a loyal dog which is going to fetch you a lot of joy every time you're going to go meet him? We decided let's ask a few people who really know about it. Right? So we said let's go and ask these kind of people who know about it. So we asked the economists, what is sustainability? They said it's internalizing the externalities. Jargon. Internalizing the externalities, it's only something that they understand. So I asked them, okay, so what is internalities, what is externalities, how do you internalize them? So externalities is when you go junk your car after its life is over, who is it that takes care that it is disposed of responsibly? The society pays a price for it. When you take a bath and when all that detergent with your shampoo and all of it runs down the drain, it goes into the public sewage. Somebody needs to take care of it so that the effluent does not reach the river. Who pays for it? Does HUL pay for it? Does PNG pay for it? Does Body Shop pay for it? These are all externality. These are costs to society, but which are not internalized in the product. So economists, being economists, thought of it in that sense that if you could internalize all of this cost, then you would have the real cost of that product or the service that you were using. And that is what they mean by internalizing the externalities. Right? So that everything would be then valued by what it costs in terms of natural capital, in terms of financial capital, so on. So that was what the economist said. Then came the businessman. Oh, it's like taxes, man. This is something I need to deal with. I'd be happier if it was not there, but I can't help it sometimes, so I have to deal with it. And then there were some progressive guys who said, oh, it looks like a whole new wave. Might be there's a lot of money to be made there. Right? So there were these thing that the business guy said. Then there were optimists like me who said it's a whole new world order. It's gonna change the way the world is. And then you had the pessimist who said it's a new fad, man. Your hole in the ozone, hole in the sky was what? Cary Grant and this is Robert Downey Jr. So it was in fashion then. Now we don't know what happened to him. We don't know if that hole still exists or if the hole is just gone. But nobody speaks about it anymore, and now you have this new word which is sustainability. So it's just a fad and it's going to be a passing fad, it's going to go. Then you had the skeptics who said, Al Gore pulled a big one on all of us. Yeah, actually there's nothing like this. Humans are not doing anything to the climate. Humans have nothing to do with it. It's one big conspiracy theory of making a lot of money on carbon. Right? So that's what the skeptics said. Then we had t-shirt designers, I'm sure some of them are here. They said it's new blockbuster, save the world, put it here, it's gonna sell like hotcakes, man. So that's all I'm worried about. And then we had developing nations like India and China who said it's a conspiracy theory by the developed nations to stop our growth after they have done all the shit that they wanted. So that was what the... And then you had the client spouse here, I'm at least gender politically correct. We would... Typically what would happen is I would be at a normal social dinner or something and you meet someone and say, what do you do? Say, I work in sustainability. Oh, meet my wife, she handles the foundation. This is the typical reaction I would get. Right? And for the spouse, why I'm saying spouses today, many women, and thankfully for that, which I would really appreciate, have broken the glass ceiling, and there are many foundations which are run by the husbands also. So given that, for them, but it was broadly looked at as a P3P opportunity. I'm going to go plant some trees, I'm going to go to some orphanage, I'm going to do something. Yeah, this is a nice thing, which is the buzz, which is the good thing to do. So that is how it had these various meanings. Right? At the end of it, confused. And if you all are all creative people, have patience with clients and things like that, then you know that whenever you present options to a client and he's confused, he comes up with this thing, let's go by the route of elimination. So let's first delete the ones we don't like. That's the very typical scenario that we see, right? So being with clients for 21 years, that's what has been conditioned into us. So we said, okay, first let's delete what sustainability isn't, right? So what is it not? Let's first take a look at it. So it's surely not saving the world. But instead of me saying it, I'm going to take a few props by a few people who have done much better work than me. And I will run a little video for you, which will tell you what sustainability is not and why it is not saving the world.
And the planet is fine. The people are fucked. Difference. Difference. The planet is fine. Compared to the people, the planet is doing great. Been here 4.5 billion years. Do you ever think about the arithmetic? Planet has been here 4.5 billion years. We've been here, what, 100,000? Maybe 200,000? And we've only been engaged in heavy industry for a little over 200 years. 200 years versus 4.5 billion. And we have the conceit to think that somehow we're a threat? That somehow we're going to put in jeopardy this beautiful little blue-green ball that's just a-floating around the sun? The planet has been through a lot worse than us. Been through all kinds of things worse than us. Been through earthquakes, volcanoes, plate tectonics, continental drift, solar flares, sunspots, magnetic storms, the magnetic reversal of the poles, hundreds of thousands of years of bombardment by comets and asteroids and meteors, worldwide floods, tidal waves, worldwide fires, erosion, cosmic rays, recurring ice ages, and we think some plastic bags and some aluminum cans are going to make a difference? The planet isn't going anywhere. We are. We're going away. Pack your shit, folks. We're going away.
Right, so first thing is, we are not saving the world. We are saving ourselves. Sustainability by basic definition means longevity over a long period of time. And that longevity is not about planet Earth. That longevity is about the human race. So that's the first thing we need to break, the myth we need to shatter. Second myth which I need to shatter is, though I'm invited here to speak on climate, sustainability is just 1/4 climate. Sustainability is a universe, climate is just a subset of it. If I want to sustain as the human race on this planet, the climate is one thing I'll need to tend to. But there are multiple other things also which one needs to tend to. And for that, it's a very interesting Indian mythology example that I like to give. It's like, we have three gods, as we were told, right? Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. Brahma is the creator. With Brahma, who do you have? Who is the goddess with Brahma?
Saraswati.
So you need knowledge if you want to create. Second is Vishnu, who's the god of sustenance. So Lakshmi, that is, you need wealth if you want to sustain. So part of sustainability is knowledge, part of sustainability is wealth, right? And the third is Shiva, which is destruction. So with destruction you have
Shakti.
Parvati, and Parvati is good intentions. So destruction with good intentions, and this is the cycle of sustainability. Right? So as Indians, it should be pretty well ingrained into us. Right? So sustainability does not say don't destroy. Sustainability also looks for destruction, but well-intentioned destruction. It looks for creation and it looks for sustenance. and you need wealth for it. So sustainability and wealth creation are not at opposite ends. They're actually husband and wife. Right, so these are some pretty key myths that I want to shatter. I won't go into depth because of the time thing, but that's the key you need to remember. Sustainability is not climate. Sustainability is not anti-wealth creation. Right? So these are two myths which are very, very well entrenched into the narrative today and which need to be shattered. Right? So what is it? Right? That's the key question. So the basic concept of sustainability, this is the theoretical definition of sustainability, but makes sense. It's development that meets the needs of the present without compromising on the future to meet their needs. So it means I will not cut a forest faster than it grows. I will not draw groundwater faster than it recharges. I will not take away all the ore in the earth so that my, you know, next generation has no ore left for them. Again, this should come very naturally to us as Indians. We create wealth for generations, right? We say, oh, I am going to leave this house for my child. It's natural for us to take care of our next generation. So this is nothing but that. It's telling you, don't blow away all your money in this generation so that your kid doesn't have nothing. It's as simple as that, and that's what sustainable development is all about. Right? Okay, let's move on to a little more nearer to business and things of commerce with which we are all more familiar with and which impacts all of us much more. So, sustainability is looked at as three bottom lines. Again, this is very classical, right? So, the first is environment, which all of us think we know, and that is just one piece of it. The second part is social, and the third is financial. For anything to sustain, typically business, you require three kinds of resources. The first resource you require is natural resource. That's where all your raw material comes from. Right? No natural resource, there will be no raw material. Including energy, everything comes from natural resource. Even wind is a natural resource. Right? So that's what the first part is. The second part, social, is human resource. If you don't have humans, there is no business. Who's going to produce? Who's going to buy? Right? So that's the second resource. And the third resource is financial resource. So if you have no capital, you won't be able to do any of that. Right? That's the way of exchange of value. Right? You can't have no finance, no social, no environment, continuity is gone. So just to go a little deeper into each one of them, so when you look at environment, you look at inputs and outputs. What is it that you input into a business? Raw material. What is the output? Waste. What do you input? Water. What is the output? Effluent. What do you input? Energy. What is the output? GHG. GHG is greenhouse gases, right? So whenever there is energy created, there is some form of gases which are emitted, right? So what you are doing in sustainability is managing the inputs and the outputs, right? By managing the inputs and the outputs, not only during your production time, but throughout the life cycle of your product. And that is the environment piece of sustainability. So if you want to sustain, you have to manage the inputs and outputs across your product, right from its conceptualization, so right at the design stage, to its end of life stage. So from Brahma to Shiva, you have to take care of all of these six input-output pairs. Right? Then you go to social. So social is human resource. All companies and all businesses broadly know human resource. HR is a department there, right? But where does the HR come from? Where does the human resource come from? It comes from society. So you need to tend to the society. It's like I want to eat the mangoes, but I don't want to take care of the orchard. Then I have a problem. I can only have the mangoes for 1 year, 2 years. If I don't tend to the orchard, so the same logic applies. If you want good human resource, you better tend to society. So there is an absolute hardcore logical business case on sustainability. It's only about one, understanding it. So when a company is doing work on a community, it is not doing philanthropy or it is not doing something benevolent about it. Right? If it understands the long term, it is doing it so that it tends to that orchard so that it can keep on reaping the fruits. So that is what you will see there, and therefore you have things like education and recognition and all of that also need to be taken care of. Third, you come to financial. In financial, there is one thing you look in annual reports, and also how much wealth did you generate. That is one thing that makes you sustainable. There is Vishnu and Lakshmi. Without the Lakshmi, there can nothing be sustainable, right? So to think that wealth is the negative is an incorrect paradigm, right? So it's like the sword to protect or the sword to kill. I mean, there are multiple, so deep debate on that, but the idea is without wealth you will not survive. If you don't generate value, you cannot create a better quality of life. So you want to live long with a better quality of life. You just don't want to live long, right? So that is the point here. But another important aspect one needs to understand in the financial part of sustainability is it's also the amount of wealth you distribute. Till now, companies were only thought that I can be as sustainable as much as the wealth I create and I hold. The paradigm has shifted. If you are not distributing enough wealth, you might not be around for a long period of time because societal license will be taken away from you. It's like what happened to the Shylocks. Any company that exploits, is not fair and equitable, will not survive for a long time. You also have one objection or a paradigm to that is that, what does Reliance say? Too big to fail. Why? Largest number of shareholders in India. What happens? If I fail, the whole economy fails. So society has invested into it to make sure they will not fail. The more the wealth you distribute, the more the people are with you to make sure that you do not fail. So your sustainability quotient goes up. So now companies also look at the amount of wealth they've distributed. How does a company distribute wealth? One is by giving dividends. Second is by paying its employees, right? Third is by the taxes it pays to the government. So there are multiple ways in which you distribute wealth, right? So are you distributing that wealth? If you start cheating on your taxes, that means you're not distributing the wealth you should. All of a sudden your sustainability quotient goes down. I'm not paying enough to my employees. Again, my sustainability quotient goes down, right? I'm not paying enough to my shareholders. Again, my sustainability quotient goes down. So it's also the amount of wealth distributed. Most people think that sustainability only works with the amount of wealth generated, right? So that is what broad level sustainability is. It's very in normal parlance as the three P's, which are called people, planet, profit, right? So profit is also important. People are important. The planet is important. Only when all these three live in harmony, can you sustain for a long period of time? Now there's another complete debate, why do we want to sustain? But that is for another day. Every species that is alive has been dead or will die. Then why are we all aiming for sustainability? But that's our innate gut to live for a long period of time. So I'm not questioning that, but that's another debate for maybe some other time when spirituality and reincarnation becomes the topic of creative mornings, we can think of that. Right? So, just to give you a little more deeper explanation between, and you saw that dot that came up, right? Here. So if it's environmental and financial, right, then it's called viable. It's viable, right? You can make some money on it and you can make it. Then when it is between financial and social, it's called equitable. I'm making money and I'm equally distributing it across society. Viable, equitable. And here it's called feasible. It's social, there's human resource to make it. Then natural resource available to make it. But it's not viable, it's feasible. Feasible means you might not make profit on it. It's only sustainable when all three are there. So it's viable, feasible and equitable. And why I'm saying this? Because as designers, you'll have to make sure all your design decisions go through these three sieves. If they don't go through these three sieves, you will realize that that decision is a diluted compromise decision. And I'll elaborate a little more on it as I go ahead on the presentation. So typically sustainability is survivability. Survival of who? For the business. So first and foremost thing you think is that I won't continue as a business, right? So I want to survive. Some example of this, how environment can jeopardize your survivability. In 2011, floods in Thailand. Okay. So what was this? 9 billion cubic meter released in October from dams filled to capacity by rainfall. Right? That was 42% above average. So when we screw around with the climate, the patterns change. The dam which was made, which was okay for 10 years, because the quantum of rainfall was X, now cannot do it because it is X into 2. Right? So where does the GHG, or what happens if I'm not putting the ignition off of my car while I'm on the red light, comes back to us in a longer way. Right? So that's what design thinking is all about, right? That's what we've been taught in design thinking, that if the butterfly flies here, how does the storm happen there? How do all these multiple parameters come together? Right? So that's what happened here, but this is only, we think of this as only floods. But there has been a huge social impact on that, which is 10,000 factories were shut, 660,000 jobs were under jeopardy. Because of this, Maruti, which sources some of the key components from Thailand, lost about 3% market share on the Swift. Honda had an issue. Western Digital, Toyota, the cost of hard disks went up. So it impacted graphic designers in Bombay because of floods in Thailand. Right? And most important, how much was the economic impact? 2.6% down on the GDP of Thailand because of floods. Which is equivalent to, if you see, if you can read down there, $6.5 billion. Right? So that is the kind of survivability we are talking of. A whole country could go down, a business could go down. Right? And these are environmental impacts. Right? Now let's move on to what could be social impacts to your survivability. What do these guys sell? Fresh produce and vegetables, right? So what kind of an ad would you do if you were launching them? You're getting fresh. So typically a Copcom manager came up with an ad which says, we cut the middlemen, buy direct from us, buy cheap, buy fresh. Simple, because that's their core promise, right? Buy cheap, buy fresh, we cut off the middlemen. All the middlemen of Orissa got together and they said, here is this big giant industrial corporation who is taking away the livelihoods of small, you know, merchants. All of a sudden that became a big societal force, and not a single Reliance Fresh retail shop was allowed to be opened in Orissa. They had the governmental licenses, but they did not have the societal license. A company with the muscle and the might of a Reliance still could not against societal might. So this is one learning. Think of it, you were the Copcom manager. Would you have got a good appraisal? That is the key. If today as a designer you are not passing them through the three sieves. He did not pass it through the social sieve. He only passed it through the economic sieve. The economic proposition was very attractive, but you didn't look at what was the social sieve. Let me give you another example of an environmental sieve like this. And L&T is one of our clients, and they were the subcontractors of the metro in Bangalore. And near Cubbon Park, there was a tree to be cut. The government law says that for every tree you are going to cut, you have to plant 100. L&T planted 1,000, let them be for 3 months so that they were well tended for, and there was what is called a survival rate. They got all the permissions. The day they went to cut it, local residents of Bangalore came and they said, we won't allow you to cut this, we are going to go hug the tree. And there was this huge tamasha which happened there. And they were right, they had their own feelings for that, right? The law allowed it. What happened? The local MLA came. He said, nahi, nahi, ye toh katna hi nahi chahiye. This cannot be cut. Well, permissions are there, everything, okay? You have mobilized all your workforce, all the equipment is on ground, right? Everything comes to a standstill. Worst thing, you have a television channel which is covering, local television channel. They see some kids serving chai, turns into a child labor issue, right? And all of a sudden, forget what happened. Your concentration, instead of you doing business, goes into this. There's a cost to that project. The project has to be delivered on a deadline. Otherwise, you have a penalty clause. All of that cost, has it been factored into while you were doing the project costing? If you have not, then you are going to lose wealth on it. So idea is that if you have to have any place where there's going to be a tree cut or where there's going to be land acquired, have you put in those costs? Have you gone and created engagement with society which is local? unless you create an engagement and take them on your side and are able to explain to them or look at alternatives, you are going to pay the price. Okay? So that is what the survivability is about. So you've seen how socially it can be, how environmentally it can be, and financial are many, right from Enron to Satyam. Right? When you're not financially prudent, how the business survivability can be completely, right, jeopardized. Right? Including the Gibson guitar. How many people can play music? I thought it's a creative one, a lot of people into there. Right? So when you look at this guitar, there is a Lacey Act which is in the US, which was amended in 2008. By that, any wood product or which is coming into the US needs to be certified. So they were about, I think, 1280 slabs of wood which had come from India, right, and which was supposedly flouting the laws of India, and therefore Gibson's factory in Nashville got raided with 20 policemen with guns and cuffs on their belt charging in. Right? Now think of two things. One is the amount of damage to your brand equity. Most musicians by basic nature care for the ecology, are people who are, you know, more globally enfranchised and are wanting to do the right thing, and they think that here is a company who is not doing the right thing. What happens to the brand equity? So all of a sudden you could lose market share. So Apple and China and the workforce, I'm sure you've heard of that also, right? So that is the idea. You can damage all the brand equity that you've built over loads and loads of years of time through a lot of hard work if you do not pay attention to these three C's. Every decision you take as a communication manager or as a design person, you need to make sure that all the three C's are taken care of. Yeah, so I had this presentation at L&T, and one of the managers there asked me, survivability is like pretty common, man. I survived like a vegetable. I didn't become entrepreneur to do that. I love taking risks. I want to see the adrenaline. I want big returns. So that is what I'm coming to. And therefore, also for a long period of time, a lot of corporate India and businesses did not embrace sustainability because they thought it's sustainability being where you are never excited them. They always wanted to be someplace else. They wanted to climb up the hill. They wanted to scale new heights. That was the thrill. As a designer, if somebody told you, you will do today what you were doing yesterday, and you will do tomorrow what you were doing yesterday, how excited do you get? So you would not embrace it, right? You might love it yesterday while you were doing it, but after you've done it, it's like, yeah, okay, once, twice, thrice, now I don't want to do this all. What we need to realize is sustainability is actually thrivability, right? And why do I say thrivability? Here is a study done by Harvest Media on consumers going to malls, and you can see that 43% of people are eco-attentive, and this is a very, very steady number which has come out through many researches and which is quite uncannily funny. But 43% are eco-attentive. Eco-attentive means I would like to buy a eco-friendly fair trade. Fair trade is also that socially fair, that is no child labor, no exploitation, no bonded labor product, if it is plus 5% in the price range. Right? So I go to buy whatever my atta and says organic, and if it's 5%, I'll buy it. Right? So still 5%, I'm ready to pay a higher price for that, and I'm eco-attentive and I know this problem exists. Then you have the eco-sensitive, who are 35%, eco-absorbed, sorry, who are the 35%. Eco-absorbed 35% means I'm ready to pay 20 to 25% premium on a product. So it's Body Shop vis-a-vis might be a what? Any of your other normal brands. So you're ready to pay higher for that, right? What has been found is that this 22% is shrinking at 10 to 15% per year. 10 to 15% of the eco-attentive are shifting to the eco-absorbed, right? So you're slowly seeing the eco-apathetic shrinking, and you're seeing both these quadrants growing, right? So 78% of the market you would lose if you were not perceived to be a sustainable brand? Can you as a designer, or can your client who employs you as a designer, afford to do that? Right? 78%. Okay. There are new customer categories coming up, very interesting customer categories. I've also heard a few different ones which are even more interesting. So just remind me to let you know after we finish this. But okay. So the first one is called Greenfluencers. Right? So there are people like me, might be the people who are the optimist in the first lot that you saw, who are actually telling people to be greener and therefore embrace a more green life. Second, you have something called the Bobos, one of the most interesting categories. I'm sure a lot of us fall into this. It's called the Bourgeois Bohemians. The Bourgeois Bohemians are the people who have the flower power and the attitudes of the 1960s blended with the materialism of the 1980s. So I'm the guy who wants to go to a nature trek, but with that I will be carrying my lithium-ion battery, iPad, iPod, my water, my steel frame bike, which will come on an SUV there, which I will ride. And I love to go to nature again and again. So I have huge consumption capacity and I have the flower power feel. You will be surprised how big a category this is. Right? And metros really thrive of that. Where do I go vacation? Sri Lanka. Next vacation, Bali. Why? Beautiful nature. And what do I carry with me? All my air miles and all. And I need my DSLR, man. Otherwise, how will the people on Facebook know where I went? So I have, and every pixel has a carbon footprint. Now that's another story, but that's also what you need to know. The servers which are running today across the world are one of the largest consumers of electricity. You don't connect to the cloud just in thin air, right? So, but that is a category which is coming up, which is better than the guy who is not even bothered about it. So I have nothing against them. I think this is the way where you slowly transition to a better place, right? So first you go to nature, then you realize what you're doing to nature, then you pull back and you do that. So they are the Bobos. There is another radical consumer category called the no-nos. They are people who believe, and partly rightly so, that big business is the evil of all society. They are the ones who lobby with government, they are the ones who, you know, completely destroy all our natural resources for their profits. Right? And therefore there's a book written by Naomi Klein, which is called No Brands. And therefore you have these large tranche of people and community living where they completely abhor brands. They live by everything without a single brand. Right? So that's another category. So you want to do handmade stuff and then there is a market now. Right? You want to create non-branded, you don't need to take any lessons on branding. All of a sudden from a good world, what is your brand and where is your logo? All of that just disappears. Right? So if this grows, a lot of us here is going to be out of business. Right? Then you have the cultural creative. This also comes from a book by Paul Ray and Ruth Anderson. Cultural creatives are people who are broadly inward looking for their self-actualization and spirituality, but care a hell lot about the ecology, about social justice, about the voice of the dispossessed. These are the kind of guys who did the whole Anna Hazare movement. So we have a huge of this in India. Right? So, and most of them will have some or the other little cultural creative habit also. I write a blog, I'm good at a little bit of poetry. That may not be my profession. Right? So this is another whole category, and you know how many people turned up for the Anna Hazare, right? And therefore you will know the numbers that exist. And the last and the most mainstream of all is called Lohas. And Lohas is lifestyle of health and sustainability. So all your big FMCGs and consumer guys know about this. So you have a Pepsi shifting from just colas to juices. You have a Saffola which is now good for your heart. Right? So lifestyle of health and sustainability is something I would say almost 99% of the mall going public is in this. I have a treadmill at home, I might not walk on it, but I at least bought it because I have a lifestyle, I want to be healthy, right? I got a Fitbit, right? And I got the Nike band, and which automatically posts on my Facebook that so many kilometers done, right? All these are for the lifestyle. So these are products which are coming out and big blockbuster products. If you don't know these categories, you will not be able to cater to them. While we might have a chuckle at them, but these are hardcore category, right? Yeah, the two other ones which are very interesting, which I heard. One was ecosexual, like the metrosexual. Now you have ecosexual and you have green singles. Right, so I don't know if they are ready to mingle, but there are green singles and ecosexuals. So these are all kinds of categories which are coming up. Some might be more niche than the other, right? So that's what, there you saw you have this 78% consumer wanting to work on it. Here you have these new consumer categories coming up. So it's about thrivability. If you want your business to have a higher demand and a higher sales, these are the categories you'll have to take care of. If you're a designer designing a product, you'll have to take care of these kind of attitudes and perceptions, even in depth. Right? The 43% that was there is again here. 43% people have said that they would be happy to have a green burial or a green last rites. So, right from a eco-friendly non-rash diaper to death. So, through the cycle, right, sustainability has made inroads throughout. Last year, right? There was a policy decision in India. There's a law now that all companies, right, 8,000 companies who have 2% CSR over and above your 100 crore mark. And so it's total amount that you have on CSR activities by corporations is 15,000 crores. Are you doing any kind of design intervention to make sure that this is used well? Forget you making money. First and foremost, there is this 15,000 crores which corporates need to spend, and I work with a lot of corporates and I know that a lot of corporates are struggling to do a due diligence and to make sure that this money is well spent. Unfortunately, design awards don't come into that. Otherwise, we could have got a... It's not community good. At least the government doesn't define it as that. So. Yeah, but that's the point. So that is the kind of money that you're looking at, right? So that's the thrivability. Okay. In a nutshell, there is a whole framework that we at Cognito have developed for sustainability and how to approach sustainability. There are these four P's that one looks at as a business when you're approaching sustainability. One, prosperity. So you saw the whole thrivability piece, right? So if you want the prosperity, you're going to sustainability. Protest. If you want to mitigate protests, you saw what the Reliance Fresh and all of those, right? So you're going to sustainability. Third, policies. So if you want to leverage policies and take care of, so then you're at the 2% and 15,000 crores, policies. Last, preservation. You want to preserve the habitat too for your business to continue. You saw the Thailand case. So there's a large amount on each one of this, but this is to give you an overview of it. So these are the four P's you have to keep in mind whenever you're taking. Are you going towards prosperity? Can there be a protest on my this design decision? Am I within the policies? And am I preserving life as usual? Not the earth. Am I preserving life as usual? Right? Or am I harming life as usual? If you're harming life as usual, that product won't last too long. Right? The CFC. Right? Discontinue. Correct? Now what does it mean for you as a designer? First thing, the brief has changed. Right? It's back to basics. As a new brief, or might be, let me say, the old brief coming back. Adam's time. We are the guys who are responsible for this problem. When the solutions of today start becoming the problems of tomorrow, let me explain. Car. A car was designed by someone. When it was designed, it was liberating. It did higher value exchange. It got you to see a lot of places which you couldn't. But today, when you have so many cars on the road, that same car which was liberating past them has become a big, big problem. And now it is actually in the diminishing return stage where every car added is impacting the quality of life that you are living. I don't know if anybody drove here from Andheri East in the morning, and then the number of cars you and the time you take and things like that. So whatever were the solutions of today, if they are going to become the problems of tomorrow, then design failed because we could not see it through and through. Very simple example, Y2K. Right? I hope there's nobody young enough here not to know Y2K. But so Y2K problem was a design problem. Somebody didn't think beyond two digits. When the 70s and the 80s and the 90s were fine, when it became 2000. But every problem comes with a huge opportunity. So Indians made a lot of money on that. The whole Indian IT scene became thriving because of the Y2K problem. Because they were on mainframes and the only guys who still knew how to operate mainframes were us. So the same thing is with sustainability. It's something that we know. Like the designers created this problem. I already gave you the pantheon of Indian gods and our core attitude and all of that. So for us, sustainability should come natural. If you only go deep, dive into it and create it into a packaged format to today's contemporary needs, right? We there again have a big wave of Indian influence across the world. It's again very funny. There have been three productivity enhancement waves in business and commerce or human life. The first one was quality. Quality came in how? Some guy made a pot, took it to the market, found out at the market that this one was cracked, so it didn't sell. So poor guy had to carry it back. Then he said, man, I don't want to carry cracked pots, so I will sit and, you know, check all my pots at my place before I take them to the market. So that became quality inspection. He checked those pots. He said, whichever were cracked, I'll leave home, so I don't have to carry them back. Then he said, but why do I produce a cracked one? So that became quality management. He said, let me take care of what I put in. So the clay I will measure and the amount of heat I'll measure and all. So quality actually raised your productivity of your resources as a concept. The second concept which came after quality was IT. Right? We all know how computers have enhanced the productivity of every resource, including human resource, including every resource. And the third is sustainability. And I think there is some pattern somewhere that they all end in T. So it's quality, IT, sustainability. Right? So sustainability is nothing but high product, right? Resource enhancement. So you are going to be enhancing your product resources. Right? So that's the core thing. So design problem. These are two gentlemen who tell you why it's interesting times to be born in. Right? The first one is Bill McDonough, who has written the book Cradle to Cradle. And the second is Paul Hawking, who's a noted environmentalist. So just listen to what they're saying.
We're at a point in our history with 6.4 billion of us that we have to imagine what it would be like to redesign design itself.
Yeah, so what would it be to redesign design itself? Partly you all are lucky. A lot of design students who are now coming into the mainstream were not taught, or just a few of them have been taught sustainability as a principle. Right? When I used to do, I'm a mechanical engineer. I have no design background, except being married to a designer, if that counts. But as a mechanical engineer, when we used to be studying papers, we had papers on planned obsolescence. Okay? You had to create a product such that you would be satisfied with it, and then it would break down. So that you would go buy a new one. Otherwise, how would the company actually, so there were all these things about make the orifice of the toothpaste larger in diameter, so that every time you put it on, more paste would come out, so it would be lesser brushes. All this was part and parcel of the connivance inside to make sure that higher consumption happened. All of these happy meals with your Coke free add-on, all of these are that. We were told to plan obsolescence, so the product had to break. The product had to fail. You were planning failure. Right? All of a sudden, the whole design principles are changing. You cannot plan failure. So you are being taught completely anew in the engineering and all of those areas. Right? So even in your own area of design, you will have to rethink of how you are doing design. Does it cross all the boxes of social and environment? Or only economic is being looked at? Right? Let's see what the other gentleman has to say.
We get to reimagine every single thing we do. In other words, there isn't one single thing that we make or systems that we have doesn't require a complete remake. And so there's two ways of looking at that. One is like, oh my gosh, you know, what a big burden. The other way to look at it, which is the way I prefer, is what a great time to be born, what a great time to be alive, because this generation gets to essentially completely change this world.
We have the opportunity to completely redesign everything there is. Right from design itself to every product, because the parameters to judge that product have changed. The minute you change the parameters that tell you if a product is good or bad, means you were looking for a redesign. Right? And as designers, what could be a more exciting time than this to be born and to be able to shape it? One, I think I am the oldest gent in this whole room, but I think as a young group, all the old fuddy-duddies like us have not got the whole gist till now. The newer ones who are behind you are still to come into mainstream. You are the guys who actually understand this concept, right? It is up to you to take it by the collar and drive it to where you want. So, it's like I said, it's a great time to be in. Everything has to be redesigned. Okay. So new products, new principles, and that means a lot of new opportunities. When you're looking at new opportunities, there are the kind of things that you will have to be careful about. First and foremost, you'll have to learn this whole new language. We call it sustainablish. We have a couple of small books like this here, which you can pick up on your way out. What it does is de-jargonizes sustainability. There are two small books in this. One is called the ABC of sustainability, which gives you some words which are oft used in sustainability, right? Like negawatt, xeriscaping. And negawatt is nothing, you don't have to get confused, it's client, not even clients, consultants like us who make up these words to make clients pay us big money. Otherwise, what do they pay us for? Negawatt means a watt save. Otherwise, that what is the measure of energy? So the energy that you would have used, which you don't use now because you have a more energy efficient mechanism in place, and every watt that is saved is called a negawatt. So tomorrow a penny saved is a penny earned, you can call it a mega penny. So that's the kind of stuff. Xeriscaping is basically landscaping with very, very little water. Right? So all these kind of words are in here, so which next time somebody talks to you, you don't feel so out of place on it. And then there is another called the long and short of sustainability in this, which is basically telling you what the acronyms are. Right? So you have a lot of acronyms like TBL. There is nothing, triple bottom line, like what you saw, people, planet, profit. So it's all pretty simple, it's all here. If you have any problems in any of the words, you can please write to me or check with me. But that is, the new language is what you will have to learn. It's like you are a typographer and you don't know kerning. If you ask someone, I do brilliant stuff on Word, man, but the guy will not know. You say, do you know kerning? You know kerning, you know. So it's like that. It's sans serif and serif, right? So all of those basically gives you the language so that you do not have to waste your head over trying to figure out the words, but are more invested into the concept. Right? So you'll have to learn the language. If you want to design, you have to learn the language. So that's one. Second, you have to move out of silo existence. So only economic, only one singular thought will not work. It has to be systemic thinking. As an engineer, I call it systems thinking. As designers, you call it design thinking. One and the same thing. Two different names for it, right? And one of the most geeks and the most cursed of IT entrepreneur, Bill Gates, and I think I might be, I can just discuss, I might be the only guy who's using a PC and not a Mac, right? But you have to, he also realizes that the next wave is sustainability and systems thinking. And can you guess what he's worked on? A very simple thought process. What causes hurricanes? Or what causes winds to move? It's the difference of temperature between water and earth, and therefore, right? The air moves from one place to another. So our man thought very simple that, can I control the temperature of the water? I cannot control the temperature of earth. Can I control the temperature of water? And therefore, slow down the hurricane or change the direction of the hurricane? So he said, okay, let's put a barge on the water, which has solar pumps, right? water below in the ocean is cool, water on the top is warm. So if I pump water from below the ocean and put it on the top of the ocean, I will cool the surface of the ocean. And if I cool the surface of the ocean, I'll slow down the winds. Simple physics, not too hard. And what he did is put solar pumps so that you don't need to take electric wires right up till there. And he put thermostats which would tell you what the temperature is. Now, can you imagine the amount of damage that hurricanes cause? Not only that, Cuba had a problem that this guy will now be able to send a hurricane to Cuba instead of going to Florida. So there was a protest on this also. Right? But that is the kind of systems thinking that the world needs now. Right? And I mean, the geeks who made Microsoft and which crashes and all its, all the things that the Mac lovers talk about it, are still thinking beyond. Right? So that is the kind of thing I mean by systems thinking. So his last name may be a group of weather experts who applied for patent. Right? So there's a patent for lowering the ocean's temperature, which Bill Gates now has. Second, address scale. Right? So move from silo thinking to systems thinking. Before that, we said learn sustainably, so learn the language. Third, address scale. The biggest issues we have are all about scale. All design products tend to fail when it comes to scale. So cars to computers. Power plants to production lines, cities. All cities become horrendous to live in once they scale. All cities are brilliant when they are first mapped out. City is nothing but a design habitat. As a designer, after so many years, haven't we able to come up with a methodology where a city can scale? Come to think of it, these are such basic issues. So whenever you think of your design product or whatever service you're doing, you have to think that can it scale? And when it scales, will it jeopardize the environmental issue or will it jeopardize the social issue? If it does, then you will not be able to scale. So when you think of a product, think of it from the start that will it be able to scale? Now we are in a globalized world. Unless the no-nos come and rule the world, then might be you don't need scale. But otherwise you need scale, right? Interesting, like I said earlier, we were talking about obsolescence. And there were two kinds of obsolescence which happened. The product failure obsolescence is the least of our worry in sustainability actually. The biggest worry is cultural obsolescence. My trouser earlier could have a 14 inch width. Today it has to have 3 inches. The trouser is functionally perfect. Still fits me, but culturally not acceptable, so I'll throw it away. My phone, there's only one guy like might be our friend Chaitanya there who still uses an old phone, but otherwise everybody has to have a new phone. Now iPhone 6 is up, so I need the 6. What, my 5 still works perfectly fine. I can't be seen with a 5, culturally not acceptable, right? So that is another thing as society we will need to address, that we are creating huge amount of cultural obsolescence. Which is in a way feeding the economy, yes. So there is a financial positive to it and there is a waste negative to it. So how do you balance it? Where does it go? Right? Now take up with HP. Toners, you use toner cartridges of HP. HP used to have an issue that everybody used to refill those toner cartridges with the local refill shop and therefore lose a lot of money on it. So what did they tell the designers, product designers? They said, start making that cartridge such that after one use of the ink, it should fail. So you found that if you like, early times you have like this HP 4 plus printer and all, in which the cartridges used to have metal parts. Right? The gears and everything being metal. Slowly it turned to plastic and then it turned to the thinnest of possible plastic. There was a designer there trying to make sure that it would be in that planned obsolescence. One round of all cartridge ink gone, the cartridge should fail. Because only then people will buy, otherwise they'll go refill. Then came sustainability onto HP. HP came out with a whole program wherein they said, put your cartridge into an envelope and mail it to us. We will take it free and we'll recycle it for you. In the developed world, the cartridge disposal is the responsibility of the user and you could be fined for it. So because it is like a e-product, it has to be disposed responsibly, people started putting it in an envelope and sending to them. They then realize that they can refill the thing and sell it back as new with the guarantee of HP. The brief again changed to the designer. Now make it such that it lasts about 50 times. Goes back, comes back. The more it lasts, the more money I'll make now. So this is how it affects you, right, as a designer. Correct? There are, I mean, with this comes, with the language of permanence and obsolescence, there are a lot of words you need to know. EPR, anybody who can, okay, to make this a little interesting that everybody doesn't sleep, this is like, let's run this like a contest. Anybody who can give me this gets a t-shirt. Unfortunately, no. Okay, somewhere there, but no. No, I mean, it's not that. It could be that, but it's not that.
Regulation? I mean, same thing, but EP, regulation.
No. Okay, it's not environment.
It's,
okay, the first one is extended.
Public relation.
Oops.
No. Reusability?
No. The first one is extended. And then you have the P and the R. Extended P. Yeah, I heard the word something.
Permanence.
Product.
Reusability.
It's product is second word, but the third is not reliability. No, it's not reusability. The second word is also not product, it's actually producer.
Responsibility.
Exactly. So anyway, let's see the... Okay, let's... There's a lady there. It's extended producer responsibility. This passive.
But that would be the... two words
a set. Yeah, so that's okay, but still you've got like the fastest finger first or whatever you can call it, who got it before the others did. Right? What is happening across the world is that producers are being made responsible for end of life disposal also. So like Gibson was made responsible for its supply chain sustainability to the product life disposal. So it's called extended product responsibility, and this comes up very interestingly. So like in the European Union, they're having a EPR, ELV, that's end of life of vehicle, and the producer's responsibility, that is you collect the car back as the producer and you dispose it of responsibly. Like HP is taking back its cartridge, a Volvo would be having to take back the car after 20 years of life of the Volvo, and then it would be responsibility of Volvo to dispose it of. So all of a sudden my capacity to address demand goes from my manufacturing capacity to my disposal capacity. If there's someone here who produces annual reports, and if you were told that you were supposed to collect all those annual reports back and dispose them off responsibly, might be guys like Arvind, they all would need like big warehouses to, you know. So you have to think of it from that angle, and all of a sudden people like HP thought, Volvo also thought like that, and they started designing in a different manner. They said, my car is going to come back to me, right? How much of it can I reuse, right? So they started designing, okay, this is another term you heard of, pay as you go, right? So this is something like that. Absolutely right. So this is pay as you throw. So that's the last t-shirt I have. So it is pay as you throw, and therefore for the amount of garbage that you are going to create as an individual, you will be charged as per that. Right? Again, these are all coming norms, and you will soon see them in India. With the Swachh Bharat, it might not be too late for the Modi government to pick up, as it is. Travel is too much, so they find out stuff much faster. So you might have that same stuff being pumped in here, right? And therefore, we are back. The DFT, I won't ask questions because I don't have any t-shirts. So it's called design for dissembly, right? So the seats, right, are designed for dissembly. When the car comes back, I disassemble it and I reuse it. And the next is designed for recycle, right? So you can disassemble it and you can recycle it, right? So as a designer, your brief changes. When you're a product designer, how will it, when it comes back, how much of it can be reused? So that's what it means, that you will have to think of it from a permanence point of view instead of an obsolescence point of view. old cliche. Function, but their time used to say function before form. Now it's become function and not form. It's how the whole system works is very important. And Bruce Mao, I think some of you as designers might know about him. Hear what he needs to say about it. So there's a.
Well, you know, the interesting thing about sustainable design is that I don't think it has to look in any particular way. One of the things that we really discovered in the last few years is that the new design is actually invisible. The new design is not about a visual boundary. The form, in fact, could, you know, the form could be anything. It's the structure and internal logic and intelligence and the performance that has to be designed.
Yeah, so it is clearly the performance that needs to be designed. So, right, aesthetics will play its part, but that's not the key in a sustainable design. You're mainly looking at the performance. At this, many times I'm asked this question, it's such a big problem, it's so much happening, what can I do? Where do I fit into this? You know, how much difference can I make? It's like vast problem. It's like I stop my car at the red signal, does it mean GHG emissions are going to go down? Right. So for that I have a video as an answer.
My experience tells me the river flows from north to south with an undertow. 20 million people sing hallelujah to all kinds of things, and I still don't know just where I'm gonna go. You got to be free to understand and feel.
Want to be doing or ambition. This is telling you that you should do something, you should not let what you cannot do interfere with what you can do, which is the way if we all of us go, then it's obviously going to be a collaborative effort to make the whole habitat sustainable, because unfortunately pollution does not know map boundaries. Right? So I mean, what we do here will impact Nepal, or what Nepal does would impact us, and what we do could impact Pakistan, and what we do could impact Bangladesh and Sri Lanka and so on and so forth. And including what might be the US might do. You know, so you still have to do your right and then work towards more and more people. So become the green influencer in that. As an ambition, I started my career in Ogilvy as an advertising guy. So all about consumption. So there is this ambition that people have when they come to an advertising agency and what you should do. So here's a small video about trying to show you what or how those ambitions are. There's a bit of irony and sarcasm in it.
I grew up, I want to work in advertising. Be forced to work 10 hours a day.
12 hours a day.
14 hours a day.
I want to work like a dog and bust my ass for a $1,500 raise.
When I grow up, I want to be an account coordinator.
A gopher. Get coffee and donuts. And sit in client meetings and contribute absolutely nothing.
When I grow up, I want to be a media director.
A buyer.
A planner.
And have my ass kissed by every media rep on the face of the earth.
When I grow up, I want to be a creative director.
Have a big head.
Save all the good TV projects for myself.
And be washed up by the time I'm 40.
When I grow up, I want to be a web designer.
A freak. Use terms nobody understands.
And convince myself I'm no longer the geek I was in high school.
When I grow up, I want to pitch new business.
Fill out mindless RFPs.
Do lots of spec creative.
Not get paid a goddamn dime for any of it.
When I grow up,
I want to be a copywriter,
a hack,
an egomaniac,
and lay awake at night writing the great American novel that will never get published.
When I grow up, I want to be an art director.
Wear black clothes.
Smoke a lot of dope.
And always help when I don't get my way.
When I grow up, I want to be in agency management.
Tell people what to do.
Get away with having a bad temper.
I want to be so far removed from the day-to-day business that I need a crane to pull my bloated head out of my ass.
When I grow up, I want to work in accounting.
Be a receptionist.
Work in HR.
And be considered as nothing more than agency overhead.
When I grow up, I want to be a production manager.
Go on press checks.
Become an expert in trash and trinkets.
And point the finger somewhere else every time something goes wrong.
When I grow up, I want to be an account executive.
A kiss up.
I want to write off time and lose any hint of a backbone every time I step into a client meeting.
When I grow up, I want to own my own agency.
Get a corner office.
See my name on the door.
And have people wonder what I do all day long.
When I grow up, I want to be a producer.
Have big budgets.
No budgets.
Pretend I'm Cecil B. DeMille.
Thank you. Any questions?